robotic process automation has emerged into the market for quite a long of time, but it has only gained popularity recently. With RPA helping the users to do tedious mundane tasks with the help of RPA tools such as Blue Prism, it has increased the job opportunities for an RPA developer. So hi all, this is Sahithi on behalf of Edureka, and I welcome you to this session on Blue Prism interview questions. In this session, guys, we'll focus on the top questions that could be asked in your interviews related to Blue Prism. So on that note, let's get started with today's session. But before that, let's take a look at the topics for today's session. So we'll start today's session by discussing the basic RPA interview questions, and then I'll talk about the basic Blue Prism interview questions. Once this is done, we'll finally talk about the advanced Blue Prism interview questions, right? So I've just divided the top questions into these sections to make you understand better. So on that note, let's get started with the first topic for today's session. But before that, I would like to request all of you to subscribe to our Edureka YouTube channel to get daily notified on the top trending technologies. Now, before I talk about the basic RPA questions, I would like to tell you that, you know, multinational companies such as IBM, Accenture, Cognizant, Deloitte, Genpact, and Ernst & Young are using Blue Prism into their day-to-day office processing. So RPA can be used in both front office and back office processing, and then you can automate any kind of task like a simple task or even a complex task. Not only this, but you can also collaborate RPA with other kinds of softwares and systems so that you make sure that, you know, it works well on an industry basis, right? So if you have to work with RPA, then you need hands-on experience in RPA tools, and Blue Prism is one of the top tools in today's RPA's market. Also, Blue Prism offers features like, you know, it's secure and accurate, it's robust, it's scalable and resilient, it offers 24/7 workforce, it provides a good analytics dashboard, it makes sure that, you know, your data is secure and performs data abstraction. It also provides cloud support and offers execution intelligence. So when I say secure and accurate, what I mean by that is that, you know, there's no limit to the number of processes which need to be executed in this particular tool, right? So Blue Prism delivers secure and accurate results to any number of processes that you wish to automate. Coming to robust, it provides various features like load balancing, data encryption, and end-to-end auditing. So every change is audited and it's reported back to the user related to it. Coming to scalable and resilient, it allows scalability with central management, so all the processes can be automated as per the need and can be monitored centrally. It also offers 24/7 workforce. So what I mean by that is that tool is designed to work intelligently without a person physically monitoring every action occurring on the screen. Coming to the analytics part, it provides extended features to configure dashboards so that the session information can be redirected to the monitoring system. When I say data security and data abstraction, what I mean by that is, you know, this tool is designed to work autonomously, right? So all the data processing is performed and is stored in the data center, and this provides a well-defined data abstraction for data and process security. Coming to providing cloud support, this provides working capacity support as per the business requirement, so the users have to just create workers on demand and manage them centrally. And finally, coming to the last point, that is execution intelligence. Well, robots can connect to the systems and react dynamically to the responses in the data on multiple environments, right? So guys, these were a few features of Blue Prism. So by now, I hope that you've understood that, you know, Blue Prism is one of the most important tools to get started in your RPA career. Right, so if you're someone who's looking forward to become an RPA developer, or you're trying to learn what RPA is, then Blue Prism is one of the most interesting tools that you can get started with. So on that note, let's get started with the main topic for today's session. So over here, I'll start with the basic RPA interview questions. So let's start with the first question, that is, mention the differences between Blue Prism, UiPath, and Automation Anywhere. Well, over here, let me tell you that, you know, all these three tools are the top three tools in today's market. So if you want to start learning RPA, then you can very well go forward with any of the tools that you wish to, right? Now, answering the question, the differences between Blue Prism, UiPath, and Automation Anywhere are as you can see on my screen. All the three tools, that is Blue Prism, UiPath, and Automation Anywhere, offer free edition. So Blue Prism has recently launched a free edition. UiPath has been having a free edition for quite a long of time now. And Automation Anywhere has also launched a community edition recently. Coming to the next point, Blue Prism is more popular than Automation Anywhere, whereas UiPath is the most popular tool, and Automation Anywhere is comparatively less popular than both the other tools. Coming to the third difference, that is that, you know, Blue Prism provides a functionality that allows the users to write the code, but obviously users can also manage without it. Coming to UiPath, it's just drag and drop functionality, so you do not need any programming knowledge. and also coming to Automation Anywhere. It's just drag and drop functionalities in Automation Anywhere. Moving on to the next difference, Blue Prism offers official certification program and UiPath has free online training and certification programs. And finally, coming to Automation Anywhere, Automation Anywhere has also launched a certification for $50. Coming to the final difference between Blue Prism, UiPath and Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism is designed for Citrix automation for BPOs. Coming to UiPath, UiPath provides desktop, web and Citrix automation. And finally, coming to Automation Anywhere, it's reasonable across all the mediums, right? So if you see all these three tools, guys, it's just the same. All of them aim to automate tasks. Right, so it's completely based on user's perspective and completely based on what kind of tool that you wish to choose and which tool will cater your requirement, right? So that was about this question. Now moving on to the next question, that is, what is robotic process automation? Now this is one of the most basic questions that could be asked in your interviews because you're going for a role of an RPA developer or maybe any other role related to RPA, right? So that means you have to have a clear understanding of what is robotic process automation. Well, if I have to define robotic process automation, then it is basically a process of automating tasks with the help of softwares or tools to deploy bots, which will reduce the involvement of humans to perform any task. So over here, if you observe, there are three terms that you have to understand, that is robotic, process and automation. Now talking about robotic first, robotic are basically those entities which mimic human actions, right? So all the entities which mimic human actions, you can consider them as robots. Coming to process, so any sequence of steps that lead to a meaningful activity is basically a process, right? Now this could be a process of making a coffee or maybe tea or maybe automating a simple task also, right? So if robots have to mimic human actions, then they have to follow a process, right? And process is basically a sequence of steps, right? So that's how it goes. Now coming to the third term, that is automation. So any process which is done by a robot without any human intervention is said to be automated, right? So that was about automation. Now, if we summarize all these three terms together, that is robotic process and automation, then mimicking human actions to perform a sequence of steps that lead to a meaningful activity without any human intervention is said to be robotic process automation. So I hope this answer was clear to you guys. All right. Now moving on to the third question, that is, what are the differences between robotic automation and screen scraping? Now the main differences between robotic automation and screen scraping are as you can see on my screen. So robots are considered to be application orchestrators. So basically, as any machine can be used by a man, similarly, the robots can also use that particular machine, right? So they could be either web service enabled applications, legacy applications, or even mainframe applications. Now coming to the second point, that is robots build a shared library by collecting procedural knowledge. Now this knowledge can be reused by any other robot or a device. And finally, coming to the third point, that is the applications which are read by the robots are either through the operating systems prior to the application display or through the screen in the context of the native application or through dedicated APIs. So in the case where applications are read through the screen in context of a native applications, the robots read the same way as that of the user. So over here, if you understand, a robot is trained and it is shown how to read the application's display similar to that of a user, right? Now coming to screen scraping. So screen scraping, as you understand, is basically to scrape data from the screen, right? So whatever data that is mentioned, that could be either the text in an image or maybe a text in a simple Word file or a notepad, all the text could be scraped and then it could be stored in a database. So that was the differences between robotic automation and screen scraping. Now moving on to the next question, that is, can you elaborate on the stages of the RPA lifecycle? Now if you have to answer this question, guys, this completely is based on your experience. So what you can do over here is that, you know, you can give an answer of the basic stages in an RPA lifecycle, and then you can talk about any past experience that you have on a project, right? So the RPA lifecycle basically has five stages and an additional stage, right? So those five stages are the discovery phase, the solution design phase, the development phase, the user acceptance test, the deployment and the maintenance phase. And finally, the additional stage is basically to execute the bots, right? Now talking about the discovery phase. So as the name suggests, in this phase, the requirements of the clients are analyzed to decide whether the process can be automated or not, right? After that, the complexity of process is analyzed along with the benefits. Coming to solution design phase, the solution or the steps to automate a task is designed in this particular phase, right? Apart from the basic requirements, a few other requirements for the project, such as the budget, the time to be spent, and the number of people working on the project are decided. Then an object model diagram or a flowchart is created to understand the flow of the process. Coming to development phase, The development phase is the phase wherein the automation developer creates automation scripts in the chosen RPA tool. Now, depending on the task to be automated or the kind of automation required, there may or may not be coding required, right? Coming to the next stage, that is the user acceptance test. So in this particular phase of RPA lifecycle, the developed bot is tested either by the testing team or the development team itself. Now, the bot is tested in the pre-production environment to test how the users can use this bot to automate a specific task. Now, coming to the next stage, that is deployment and maintenance phase. After developing and testing a bot, if the bot is ready, then the bot is deployed into the production environment, right? And finally, coming to the additional stage. So basically, in this particular stage, the bots are executed and thereafter checked to generate the meaningful results. So guys, this was a gist about the RPA lifecycle. If you want to know in depth about RPA lifecycle, then you can refer to my session on RPA lifecycle. On that note, let's move forward to the next question. That is, what are the differences between RPA and automation? Now, this is one of the most confusing questions because, you know, people often get confused between what is the difference between the terms simple automation and robotic process automation. So let me clarify the confusion for you. So we'll be comparing RPA and automation based on few parameters that you can see on my screen. So starting with the first one, that is, what does it reduce? Now, RPA basically reduces the manual workforce, whereas automation reduces the execution time. Coming to the next parameter, that is need for programming knowledge. Well, RPA mostly is wizard driven, so it does not need programming knowledge. Whereas if you come to automation, then programming knowledge is required to create test scripts. Now, coming to the third difference, that is based on the parameter usage. RPA is basically used in the production environments, whereas automation is used for QA, production, performance, and UAT environments. Coming to the next parameter, that is, what does it automate? So RPA aims to automate repetitive business processes, that is product as well as business. Coming to automation, automation aims to automate repetitive test cases, that is a product. Now, finally, coming to the last parameter, that is, what are the working environments? Then RPA works on a wide range of environments, whereas automation works on limited environments. So guys, these were the differences between RPA and automation. Now, moving on to the next question, that is, what are the features of RPA? Now, this is also one of the most common questions that is asked in your interviews. So the features of RPA, as you can see on my screen, RPA is accurate, consistent, it's a cost-cutting technology, it has good productivity rate, it's a reliable software, and no or less coding is required. Now, talking about accurate, it's basically less prone to errors and works with high precision and uniformity. Coming to consistent, the RPA softwares are built in such a way that all the repetitive tasks are performed in the same manner. Coming to cost-cutting technology, it aims to reduce the manual workforce and thus reduces the cost used to perform any task. Moving on to the productivity rate, the execution time to perform any task is much faster when compared to that of the manual approach. Moving on to the next one, that is reliable software. This software is reliable as bots can work 24/7 without a break and also with the same efficiency. And finally, moving on to the last point, that is no or less coding is required. Now, this is basically because RPA tools are wizard driven, so it's basically drag and drop in almost all the RPA tools. So because of that, you do not need much coding knowledge. So even if you're from non-IT background, you can definitely go forward and choose RPA as your career. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward and look into the next question, that is, mention the differences between thin clients and thick clients. Well, thin client is basically an application that we cannot get the quality properties while spying using any RPA tool. Coming to thick client is an application from which we get a pretty handful of attribute features using any RPA tool. So the example of thin client is any virtual environment, and the example of thick client could be a calculator or even Internet Explorer, right? So guys, that were the differences between thin client and thick client. Now moving on to the next question, that is, can you mention a few general requirements of RPA for front office and back office processing? Well, for this particular question, there's no definite answer, but you can answer the interviewer by saying that apart from the tools and the client requirements, most of the requirements are the same for both front office and back office processings. So the same configuration can be easily deployed and the results that can be derived are always superior in every aspect. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the differences between Selenium and RPA? Now the differences between Selenium and RPA, as you can see on my screen, we'll be looking into the differences based on few parameters. So starting with the first parameter, that is automation. Well, Selenium automates browser applications, whereas RPA automates business processes. Moving on to the next difference, that is based on availability. Selenium is open source and same goes for RPA. RPA is completely based on RPA tools. So if you look into the top tools such as UiPath, Automation Anywhere, and Blue Prism, then all the three tools offer Community Edition or the Free Edition. But apart from this, they also offer Enterprise Edition with better features. So if you're working on RPA in an enterprise, then you can go forward with the Enterprise Edition. But if you want to get a hands-on experience in any of the RPA tools, then you can choose the Community Edition. Moving on to the next difference, that is, where is the task performed? So in Selenium, the task is performed on the current browser page, whereas in RPA, the task is performed at the backend of the process. Coming to the next difference, that is the major component used. In Selenium, the Selenium web drivers are used, whereas in RPA, the RPA bots are used. Coming to lifecycle, well, the lifecycle of Selenium is comparatively difficult when you compare it to RPA, right? So RPA lifecycle is very simple and easy, but it's not the same with Selenium. It's comparatively difficult, but I would say not very difficult, right? Coming to platform and dependency, well, Selenium is basically dependent on the browser, so it's browser platform dependent, and RPA is platform independent, right? So it's not dependent on any particular platform. You can use RPA on various kind of applications. Coming to programming knowledge, well, in Selenium, you definitely need programming knowledge, but when it comes to RPA, you do not need programming knowledge, or I would say you require less programming knowledge. Coming to the skills, well, to work on Selenium, you should have an idea about the Selenium ID. So you have to understand how to create a test suite. But when it comes to RPA, then you need an understanding about the SQL databases, analytical skills, problem solving ability, managing data, and also the knowledge of RPA tools. So guys, these were the differences between Selenium and RPA. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what points are to be considered during the planning phase of automation? Well, during the planning phase of automation, you have to consider the points that you can see on my screen. You have to make sure that, you know, you choose the best RPA tool for your project. You collect the in-scope and out-of-scope parameters. You have a testing environment. Then you have project timelines and also have an identification of the deliverables. So these are a few points that you have to consider during the planning phase of automation. But yes, if you have any other points on your mind, then you can definitely go forward and mention those points also. So guys, with this question, we come to an end to this particular section. That is the basic RPA interview questions. Let's move forward with the next section, that is the basic Blue Prism interview questions. So let's get started with the first question in this particular section, that is, do we require coding skills to use the Blue Prism tool? Well, I would say this is one of the most common questions asked in interviews. The answer to this particular question is no. So the Blue Prism does not require any programming knowledge, as it has developed its digital workforce in a way that it can be built and managed by the users. Apart from this, Blue Prism has also made sure that, you know, its digital workforce adheres to the spanning technologies, operations, and robotic operational model to make sure that, you know, it can be implemented in any department of the enterprise. Also, to a matter of fact, all the RPA tools require no or less programming knowledge, as all their platforms are built in such a way that a user does not sit and writes the code. So guys, that was about the first question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what is the need for Blue Prism in the market? Now, since robotic process automation or RPA cannot be implemented without the RPA tools, Blue Prism is one of the most popular RPA tools and is used to design automation scripts for various departments and tasks. So Blue Prism supports both internal and external encryption or decryption of the keys. Apart from this, it also enables audit logs, which makes it easy for the users to debug. Well, guys, these were just few points, but I'm sure once you start using the tool, you will understand the benefits of Blue Prism, right? So you can definitely answer the interviewer with the benefits of Blue Prism, which companies are using Blue Prism and where it stands in today's market. Now let's move forward with the third question, that is, what do you understand by the environmental variable in Blue Prism? Now, environmental variables are those variables that are available to all the processes and business objects. So these variables are used as dynamic variables to make sure that they can be used whenever required across the Blue Prism platform. Now, to use an environmental variable, you have to follow the steps that you can see on my screen. You have to add a new data item to the chosen process or object. You have to next open the data properties form, and in this particular form, in the exposure combo box, you have to select the environment option. Then the name edit box at the top of the screen will become a combo box. So then you have to select the environmental variable that you want to choose from the combo list and then click on OK. Right? So guys, that was about the environmental variables. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what kind of support is required from the Blue Prism professional services? Now, Blue Prism offers a wide range of services. So it's completely dependent on the abilities that you already have and what you wish to learn next. So Blue Prism can provide complete training to learn the tool and offers 24/7 support to ensure that you learn the tool quickly and start automating tasks. Over here, Blue Prism takes the complete responsibility of delivering business benefits within the agreed service levels. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, can you mention the hardware requirements used to execute the Blue Prism platform? Well, I would say there are as such no hardware requirements, but since Blue Prism is designed to match the IT standards suitable for the IT security, operational integrity, and operational supportability, this software is designed in a ready-to-be-deployed manner. So in front office processing, it runs on the standard or local desktop, whereas in the back office processing, it runs on large number of systems. Now moving on to the next question, that is, what do you understand by visual business object? The visual business objects are used to provide an interface to the application. Now this application interface is basically not configured in the process studio, but yes, it is configured in a separate environment called an object studio environment, right? So a business object is not exposed to the control room, but it is always used by a process. So guys, that was about visual business object. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, mention the components in Blue Prism. Now Blue Prism comes with various tools, libraries, and runtime environments to enable the users to automate tasks. But out of all of them, there are mainly two components of Blue Prism. They are the Process Studio and the Object Studio. Now the Process Studio is the area in which the process diagrams are created. So this component of Blue Prism offers features such as business logic, object call, control loops, and variables. So each and every process created has the main page which gets executed first. Now coming to Object Studio, almost all the enterprises need to have a communication with the external applications to automate tasks, right? So since it cannot happen in Process Studio, over here, Object Studio is used. Object Studio is the area where the visual business objects are created. Now these objects are nothing but the diagrammatic programs interacting with the external applications that perform the operations, right? So one business object provides an interface with only one external application. And also, let me tell you that each Object Studio does not have the main page, but it does have two default pages organized as a flat group. So guys, that was about the components in Blue Prism. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by process in Blue Prism? Now, a process is quite similar to that of a business object. So it acts like a human user and implements a software robot logic. Now, each and every process is defined by using one or more pages where each page contains various stages. Also, a process always starts as its main stage and then carries forward to the other pages. Now, over here, each page has its own individual tab to ensure that the processes are divided into various logical groupings, right? So, guys, that was about process in Blue Prism. Now, let's move forward with the next question, that is, mention the steps to create a process in Blue Prism. Now the steps to create the process in Blue Prism are as you can see on my screen. You have to open the Blue Prism window and then you have to choose the studio icon. After that, you have to right click the processes heading under the studio tab and then select create a process. After that, you have to enter the name and description of the process, and once the process is created, it will appear beneath the process heading. Right, so over here, just double click on it to open. And now once the process is open, the next step is to add a stage. So to do that, go to the Stages toolbar on the left-hand side and drag it into the workspace. After that, the stage is added and you can go forward and create the process flow, right? So guys, these were a few steps that you have to follow to create a process in Blue Prism. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, how can you get started on delivering processes using Blue Prism? Well, Blue Prism recommends a phased approach to get started, as the operational agility framework is scalable. Now this kind of environment is used to target the configuration between 1 to 10 processes initially, and then rolling program of processes is being introduced once the framework is established. So that's how basically you can get started with delivering processes in Blue Prism. On that note, let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the steps to deploy Blue Prism applications? Now to deploy Blue Prism applications, we need the tools control room and the system manager. Now basically both these tools let you perform the tasks that you can see on my screen. That is, start and stop the instance of Blue Prism processes, view the logs produced by each and every Blue Prism process, either when the process is running or after the process has ended, right? Apart from this, it also records the log when each and every stage of the process is executed. The tools let you create process schedules according to the schedule defined by the user, and also lets you view the work queues to examine how far the processes have got an input file and what are the exceptions which have occurred. So over here, you have to note 2 points, that to deploy Blue Prism applications, you need control room and system manager. You need a good understanding of how to use both of these tools. And also you need to understand that, you know, what tasks can be performed using these two tools, right? Now let's move forward with the next question that has mentioned the steps to create an action in Blue Prism and publish it. Now, actions are basically used to implement the logic of a business object. Now, each action contains data items having the information used by each action along with a set of stages. Now, to publish an action, it has to be called by the processes or any other software. An action can also remain private. So when you make an action private, it is only available to other actions in the business objects. Apart from this, an action always starts with the start stage and finishes at the end stage. Between both these stages, other stages are responsible to carry out the tasks which are present. Now, the steps to publish an action are quite simple. You have to right-click on the action's name and choose Publish from the context menu. Then once the action gets published, an icon appears next to the name of action to indicate it's published. So guys, that's how basically you can publish an action. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by Blue Prism's process template? Now, Blue Prism's process template is used as a base for all the processes created in Blue Prism. So these templates ensure processes are easy to configure and support. Also, they help the user to understand how the work queues are used in all the processes which are created. Now, with the help of process templates, you can also do the tasks that you can see on my screen. You can know where the work queues are loaded and where the get next item action is used. You can route all the complete cases through the resolve item page and the exception items through the resolve exception page. You can also develop and support having multiple mark exception and mark completed stages throughout the process. You can do fast process development since the examples are provided for different work queues loading scenarios. And also it makes you easy to familiarize yourself with existing processes following the similar templates. So guys, that was about the Blue Prism's process template. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by SDD and FRQ? Now, SDD or Solution Design Document is basically used to describe the Blue Prism's automation process derived in the process definition document. And coming to FRQ or Function Requirements Questionnaire, this is basically used to provide areas for consideration and also acts as a checklist for required details. So that was about SDD and FRQ. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, can you mention few ways to secure your applications in Blue Prism? Now there are basically three ways through which you can secure your applications. It could be through user, through credentials, or through options. Now the user is basically used to assign new user information. The credentials is basically used to store the secret information. And coming to options, options are used to set the rules for setting passwords, right? Apart from this, Blue Prism also offers role-based access control for security. So through this, the Blue Prism administrator defines what roles a user can act in and the system which will allow the user to perform only the actions allowed by these roles. So an administrator can also examine the records of activities such as when a user logs into the Blue Prism, when that particular user starts or deletes a process, and when that user changes his or her password or any other further actions, right? So guys, these are a few ways to secure your applications in Blue Prism. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what is the use of global mouse click and global send keys? So the global mouse click and the global send keys are examples of operations that need an active application. In the scenario where the application is not from front end, operations will click or type into whichever window is active. So this could also be a different application or an empty desktop completely. So basically guys, global mouse click and global send keys are examples of operations which need an active application. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, elaborate the different phases of Blue Prism lifecycle. Now there are mainly three phases of Blue Prism lifecycle, that is a phase 1, 2 and 3. Now in phase 1, the developer and tester work with each other to prove that the automation solution verifies with the process definition document. In phase 2, you will repeat the phase 1 in Process Studio where the tests are executed in live data testing more often. Coming to phase 3, in phase 3, you have to test the final solution where the process solution is installed with the test environment. Then the solution is in such a way that, you know, it should be able to manage the performance of the environment and in any other further issues, like, you know, if there's any problem or maybe more servers are required and so on. Then the process runs in the control room of Blue Prism, and then the acceptance criteria must publish the sign after meeting a full test report. Once this is also done, the process is executed in the production environment. So guys, these were the stages of a Blue Prism lifecycle. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are work queues in Blue Prism, and mention the steps to set the priority for work queues in Blue Prism. Now work queues are mostly used to break large volumes of work into small volumes. To do this, multiple bots can be used to reduce the time consumption. And also, a work queue is one of the most efficient ways to deploy the bots. So if you're working in queues, you have to set the priorities for a queue item. And to do that, you have to first add the item into the queue with the help of the add to queue action. And then you have to work with the queue item to start the priority of the process started. Once the priority of the item is added to the queue, then it cannot be changed. So that was about work queue in Blue Prism, guys. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, where are the tags used in Blue Prism? Now, tags are basically keywords of terms which are assigned to the work queue items. So these tags are used when you want to retrieve the next item from the work queue. Now, you can also filter the items to be retrieved from the presence or the absence of a specific tag, and by giving appropriate arguments to the tag filter input parameter of the getNextItem action. Also, multiple tags can be used by using semicolons. So if I have to give an example for you, then you can see an example on my screen. I've used work type 1 and then I put a semicolon. Then I've used student type 2, then I've put a semicolon. And then I've said minus work type 2 over here. So here the next item will have work type 1 and student type 2 tags and will not have the work type 2 tags because it has a negative symbol, whereas the work type 1 and student type 2 have the positive symbol. So guys, that was about tags in Blue Prism. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is Blue Prism's platform secure and auditable? Well, I would say yes. Blue Prism's platform is definitely secure and auditable, as both security and auditability are built into the Blue Prism's platform at several levels. In Blue Prism, the runtime environment is separate from the process of editing that environment. And also there are specific permissions to design, create, edit, and run processes for each and every authorized user. Apart from this, a full audit trial of changes to any process is kept with the comparison of before and after effect of the changes provided. And also the log created at the runtime for each and every processes provides a detailed timestamp history of every decision and an action taken within an automated process, right? So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what do you understand by multiple part processes? Now, as the name suggests, multiple part processes are used in a scenario where a case needs to be worked in multiple parts at different items. So it comes with parent-child relationships where individual work items must be linked to a single request. This can also be used where work is driven from an external system rather than from the Blue Prism's work queue. Not only this, but the multiple part processes can be used where the requests are added throughout a day and must be executed in the service level agreement period. So guys, that was about multiple part processes. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what is an application modeler? Now, the application modeler is basically used to interact with the applications. Through this, you can configure only one application, but you can definitely go forward and override or replace existing configurations with new configurations. Apart from this, you can also answer the interviewer by adhering to the local naming convention where it is typically element type hyphen element name. So over here, if I have to give you an example, then you can give an example like, you know, if you want to create sections for the screen with each part, then the application modeler makes the support easier and mitigates the risk of being repeatedly spying at incorrect elements. So guys, that was about application modeler. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, explain the attach option in Blue Prism. Now the attach option is used to identify which application is being used and you need to input the value to help it identify the application. For example, it could be a Windows title or a process name. So that was about the attach option. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what do you understand by the preserve checkbox and when to use it? Now, when you check in the preserve checkbox, the exception type and exception detail fields are disabled. So when we check in the preserve checkbox, the current exception is to be re-released or thrown again and no further details are necessary. Now, due to this, the preserve checkbox must be used in the recovery mode, which is between the recover stage and the resume stage. Also, if you use the checkbox outside the recovery mode, it will then generate an exception. So that was about this particular question, guys. Now let's move forward with the final question for this particular section. That is, explain the usage of dynamic match type. Now the dynamic match type allows the users to specify the value of an attribute from the diagram rather than use one present in the application modeler. So you can understand the dynamic match type as a mandatory input parameter required by any of the stage using elements. So guys, that was about the dynamic match type. Now with that, let's move forward with the next section for this particular session. That is advanced level Blue Prism interview questions. So over here, let's start with the first question. That is, what do you understand by OID and PDI? Now, OID or operational impact document is used to inform the operations team what is responsible for the changes after the automation solution is designed. So it's basically a description of the change which has impacted them after the implementation of the solution successfully. Also, to check the execution of the automation solution's impact on the business, a workshop is conducted by the process definition document. Now coming to PDI or process design instruction, it is basically a blueprint that develops a process where the information with the low level can be included in PDI after excluding it from the software definition document that makes the process clear, right? So guys, that was about OID and PDI. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what is the active accessibility interface in Blue Prism? Now the active accessibility interface is much slower than that of the default Win32 interface, but the active accessibility interface is compatible with more type of interface elements. So when automating Windows native applications, active accessibility should be only used when elements are not compatible or cannot be reliably targeted using the Win32 spy mode. Also, to improve the performance of the active accessibility interface, the match index and the match reverse can be used. So while using this interface, multiple matches can be found even though the elements seem to be unique. And this might happen because some elements may exist when they are not displayed. So guys, that was about the active accessibility interface in Blue Prism. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the steps to create a web service in Blue Prism? Now the steps to create a web service in Blue Prism are as you can see on my screen. You have to open the Blue Prism Studio and then you have to create a web service group. After that, you have to create a simple object, let's say sample calculator, and then you have to enter the details of the web service. After the object is created, you have to double click on the object and then open the object studio. And over here, you have to click on the first action button, that is action one button, and then add an action by right clicking on that particular button. After that, you have to double click on the action and this will navigate the page information where you have to provide the description such as multiply two numbers and then return the results. After that, you have to click on OK. Now over here, since we are trying to multiply two numbers, to do this, you need to select the calculation option. So to do that, what you have to do is you have to double click on the sample calculator and then you will be navigated to the calculation properties. Over here, you have to provide the name. So for example, let's say I provide the name to be multiply two numbers. Then what you have to do is in the expression field, you have to create two numbers just by clicking on the numbers option. So let's say over here, we create two input numbers, that is data one and data two, and an output number to be data three. Now after that, what you have to do is you have to drag the input numbers and then also drag the output number data three in the result. After that, you have to click on the validate button. Now after that, what you have to do is you have to click on the evaluate expressions where you have to enter the value of data one and data two, and these will be sorted in the temporary values and then you will find the result value after clicking on the test button. Next, what you have to do is you have to link the start button where the input numbers are given to multiply two numbers box and then add it to the end where the output number is data three. After that, you can test the diagram by clicking on the go button and then save the business object by clicking on the save button. Finally, you can check whether the process is working or not by clicking on the go button and giving the inputs. So guys, that was about how to create a web service in Blue Prism. Now, these were few steps that you can give as an example. But yes, if you have any other example in mind also, you can definitely go forward and talk about that. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, elaborate on how does a process run in the control room. Now when a process is running in the control room, you can stop the process either by clicking on the stop section or by selecting the process session. Now both these methods will stop the process immediately. So in case the current process is not completed, then Blue Prism will mark it as an exception at cleanup. Also, there are two stop options you'll see while making the right click on the running process session, that is the request stop and the immediate stop. So the request stop basically asks the processes to stop at a configured safe stop in the process. Coming to immediate stop, this option just behaves like the stop section. So it just immediately stops the process. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by wait stage and the options always throw an exception on timeout and always wait for the screen to change? Well, the wait stage is used to get the wait timeout upon double clicking on the wait stage. The default timeout should be around 5 seconds. So as we give the wait stage upon running the object, it will wait till the time given by the user to perform an action occurs. So this basically aims to increase the resilience of the process. Now coming to the option, always throw an exception on timeout, you should not try to retrieve the process through the wait stage. Instead, you should try an exception and let the process handle it, as it may choose to restart the system or retry after a few times or retry after an alert. Coming to always wait for the screen to change, well, you should use the wait stage after navigating to any stage, which is the reason that is required to update the screen. So this ensures to run fast by not absorbing any latency. Now coming to the next question, that is, what are the recommendations for automated solutions working short SLA? Well, the recommendations for automated solutions working short SLA, that is the service level agreement or real-time request, are as you can see on my screen. Now, since Blue Prism follows the practice of never finishing the work instantly and always follows a work queue to process the work via the user interface, you can separate the work request confirmation from the work. For example, if a work request comes via the web service call, the Blue Prism must add the request to a work queue and give an output that the request has been received. Coming to the next point, you can also allocate enough robots to ensure that those robots work with the work queues at peak times with the expected SLA. Apart from this, a method of controllers must be designed in a solution to inform the users if an SLA is being missed or if it's at risk. So work queues can be also reported up to the estimate whether the available capacity is enough to meet the expected workloads at peak time or not. Coming to the third point, robust contingency can be met as it is an integral part of the Blue Prism framework. So here you have to make sure that the expected SLA are included in the contingency plans. Now moving forward with the next question, that is, what is the purpose of business objects, and also explain the way to check the object attached with the application or not. Now the main purpose of business object is to provide an interface to a single application. Business objects are not exposed to the control room and are used by the processes. So as I mentioned before, business objects are not exposed to the control room and are used by the processes. So to check whether an application is attached to the application or not, you need to use the top or the root element in an application model. Then you have to select the option read operation, and once you select this option, the business object will be connected. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by the session variables and where are they used? So the session variables are those variables which are applicable to sessions like running processes. So similar to the environmental variables, the session variables are exposed outside the diagram. So on running the processes, session variables are very specific. So if two instances of processes are running at the same instance of time, both these instances will have the same session variables with different values. So there is no need to set up the session variables in the system manager, but in the control room, you can see and modify the session variables. Also, all the data items are writable and are exposed as session variables. Now coming to the next question, that is, what do you understand by the new environmental variable stopping time, a value of 3 or 4 minutes from now, and with the data type time? Well, a new environment variable named stopping time has a value of 3 or 4 minutes from now and has a data type time. So to use this variable, you have to create the latest process named as stopping time, and then you have to create a data item. And finally, you can use this exposure field to link it with the environmental variable. Now moving forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by mark exception and system unavailable exception in Blue Prism? So the mark exception has two flag inputs, that is the keep locked and try, which are used to control the features. So as soon as a new item is developed, it will return its ID into the output parameter of this particular new item. And also if the keep locked flag is set to true, then the new item will be under the control of the process. Coming to system unavailable exception, these exceptions are generally seen when you're not able to launch the application. So this could be either because of not responding applications, a new screen of an application, application crashes, or changes within an application that were not considered during the design and the development stage. Now moving forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by match index? Well, if you want to search for an element from top to bottom, then you have to use the match index. Now once the element is found, Blue Prism will stop searching instead of continuing to search for potential duplicates. So using this attribute, you can increase the search speed, but this is generally used when the duplicate elements are either ignored or are unlikely to be present. And also, if you use the match reverse option, then this will make Blue Prism search in the bottom to up order rather than the top to bottom order. So guys, that was about match index. Moving forward with the next question, that is, what are the steps to run more than one instance of a process? Now, while accessing more than one instance of the process, there are chances that those instances clash with each other. So for example, let's say you have a process that holds a task to access a shared file, but you need to run more than one instance for this particular process, then how do you think you will be able to avoid the clash between the instances? Well, you can definitely do that by removing the file accessing sequence from the process and then put it in a separate process which will run on a single machine. Now, apart from this, one more way is to use the Blue Prism's environment locking feature to control the access to the file. So this lock is a token or a key which a process must obtain as a permission to take the particular path as an input. So when there are more than one instance of a process running and only a single lock is present, the instances must be complete for that particular lock. So guys, that was about this particular question. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what are the two main methods of Blue Prism processes getting work from a workflow system in Blue Prism? So the two main methods of a Blue Prism processes getting work from a workflow system are as you can see on my screen. So the first method is to load all the work from the workflow system into a Blue Prism work queue all at once. So through this, the Blue Prism robots will get the items to work with the work queue instead of the workflow system. Coming to the second method, the robots in Blue Prism get cases to work directly from the workflow system. So for each and every case, an item is added to the Blue Prism work queue and is immediately logged from the work. Now coming to the next question, that is, what do you understand by the recover stage? Well, the recover stage basically catches the exception by giving the user the opportunity to create various kinds of recovery sequences. So as soon as the exception is caught, the business object or the process is said to be in the recovery mode, implying that the exception is live. Now coming to the final question for this particular session, that is, what is a connector in Blue Prism and mention the types of it? Well, the connector in Blue Prism is used to handle low-level interactions with an application's user interface. So as a user can use various kinds of application interfaces, Blue Prism provides a variety of connector choices. So they are basically the HTML connector, the Java connector, the Windows connector, the Citrix connector, and the mainframe connector. So talking about the HTML connector first, this connector allows the user to work with HTML, ActiveX controls, JavaScript, and other components of the browser interface. Coming to Java connector, it allows the users to work with Swing, Oracle, Java applets, and other JVM-based technologies. Coming to the Windows connector, it gives the users access to the Windows, so the applications using the .NET framework, Power Builder, Visual Basic, and the Microsoft Foundation class library, and also the other Windows-based user interfaces or technologies. Coming to Citrix connector, so the Citrix connector allows the users to access applications which provide users interface via the technologies such as Microsoft Remote Desktop Services and Citrix XenApp. And finally, coming to the last connector, that is the mainframe connector. So this connector is used to allow access to mainframe applications through terminal emulators from various vendors such as IBM, Attachmate, and so on. So guys, this was all about connectors. With this, we come to an end to this particular session. I hope you've understood the top questions that could be asked in your interviews. So if you're someone who is preparing for an interview related to RPA, then I must say you must definitely go forward and understand all the questions related to all the other tools. So do upskill your career and I hope you crack your interviews related to RPA. So if you have any further queries related to the session, please comment down in the comment section below. Until then, that's all from my side today. I hope you found the session informative. So thank you and have a great day.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it and you can comment any of your doubts and queries and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!